threatens both of us, he's got to go.
Verse.
Oh, so Sadducees, very connected to politics and politicians. Huh, might that ever happen today?
The next up is?
There we go. I didn't know this. Billy Graham, during his lifetime, met with 12 consecutive American presidents. That is incredible. One, that anybody would meet more than one president, much less 12. That anybody would have any kind of influence with 12 presidents. Now, if you are Christian, you probably think this is wonderful. If you are not Christian, this is a very disturbing intersection of one specific understanding of one faith and highly influential political leaders. Sadducees had tight connections with politics. All right. There's all your setup. So now, let us open our hearts, our minds, and our souls as our reading today invites us to consider what belongs to God and what gives us comfort in the afterlife. Oh, I'll be playing the role of Pharisees first, then Sadducees.
Our reading today comes from Mark 12, verses 13 through 27. After Jesus preached the parable of the wicked tenants, some Pharisees, some of Herod's supporters, banded together to entrap Jesus. They came to Jesus and complimented him.
Teacher, we know you are truthful in what you say and that you do not play favorites. You're not worried about what anyone thinks of you.
Certainly after that temple thing.
So you teach with total honesty what God would have us do. So tell us, is it lawful that we Jews should pay taxes to the Roman emperor or not? Should we give to our oppressors or not?
Seeing through their ruse, Jesus replied, why do you test me like this? Listen, bring me a coin so I can take a look at it. When they had brought it to him, to Jesus, he asked him another question. Tell me, whose picture is on this coin? And whom does this inscription speak?
Caesar, of course.
Then give to the emperor what belongs to the emperor, and give to God what belongs to God. They could not think of anything to say to his response. Later, a group of Sadducees, Jewish religious leaders, who didn't believe the dead would be resurrected, came to test Jesus.
Teacher, if the law of Moses tells us, if a man's brother dies, leaving a widow without sons, then the man should marry his sister-in-law and try to have children with her in his brother's name. Now here's the situation. There were seven brothers. The oldest took a wife and left her a widow with no children. So the next oldest married her, left her a widow, and again, no children. So the next brother married her and died. And the next. Finally, all seven brothers had married her. But none of them had conceived children with her. And at last, she died also. Tell us then, in the resurrection, when humans rise from the dead, which, by the way, remember, I don't believe in. In the resurrection, whose wife will she be? For all seven of them married her.
Jesus replies, you can see the truth because you don't know the scriptures well and because you don't really believe that God is powerful. The answer is this. When the dead rise, they won't be married or given in marriage. They'll be like the messengers in heaven who are not united with one another in marriage. But how can you fail to see the truth of resurrection? Don't you remember in the book of Moses how God talked to Moses out of a burning bush? And God said to him, and then, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. I am. God said, not I was. So God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. You are sadly mistaken. The word of life for all the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
This is incredibly insulting the way Jesus did. He tells the Sadducees, people who have dedicated their lives to knowing the Torah inside and out. He basically says, you have no idea what you're talking about. You completely missed the point. Not once. He does it three times. Oh, rubbing salt in the wound. All right. Jesus, we'll start with the first story. Jesus' answer to the tax question is brilliant in its simplicity. He acknowledges the earthly realm with its material systems of taxation and governance, while also affirming a power that is higher both in authority and longevity. But what exactly belongs to God? The easy answer could be everything. God created the heavens and the earth. God created everything, from atoms to galaxies. Cool. So how do we give that back to God? Jesus' answer presses us to move beyond the literal material world. Think about the incredible, intangible gifts God has given us. We have our souls, we have our bodies, we have our minds, and our capacities to love and have faith. None of these are things that we have created ourselves. They are inherent parts of who we are, parts that connect us to God and each other. Terrific. So how do we give these back to God? When someone joins the United Methodist Church, they profess seven traditional baptismal vows. These are reaffirmed every time we baptize someone. The person being baptized makes the vows for all to hear, and all who are present reaffirm their commitment to those vows. I'm sure you have them all memorized, right? One of the vows is that we will faithfully participate in the life and ministries of our local congregation through our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our worship. These are in your bulletin inserts. You don't have to write them all down. But how can we live into those vows? The more I thought about today's reading and what Jesus said, the more I see an intersection here. From a Methodist perspective, this, living into these vows, is how we can understand what it means to give back to God what is God's. Prayer. Prayer can include moments of quiet reflection, saying traditional prayers, expressing gratitude to God or someone else, or simply connecting with the beauty and wonder of creation around us. Prayer can take so many forms when we think of it as conversation with God. Sharing our presence with another person is a powerful way of letting the God in us connect with the God in others. We can do that in person, on the phone, or through text or email messages. Never underestimate the power of communicating in whatever form to someone. Just wanted to say hi, I've been thinking of you. That's it. As soon as I say, giving our gifts to God, you naturally assume I'm talking about money. Okay, that's part of it. But our community of faith depends on all of us offering our time, our talents, and our treasures with each other and with our church. That combination of gifts enables us to do the many ministries of our church. And I have to say, you guys, all of y'all, are so incredibly generous with your time, your talents, and your treasures. You are generous with your enthusiasm for the things that you care about and the people you care about. And that is a blessing for which I give thanks every day. So, first one's prayer, presence, gifts. Fourth is service. When we serve others, we care for the presence of God within the people we serve. The Methodist Church's long tradition of addressing social justice issues is continually informed by our experiences of serving others. Anyone who has done an act of service toward others, you get to know the people you serve, and you find out their needs may have changed over time or are not what you anticipated. I have to say, one of the things I love most about the Methodist Church is we adapt over time. And as we serve our communities, we find out what the local needs are, and we say, okay, we'll adjust. Here's how people need us now. Here's how people need compassion put into action now. Finally, giving God our witness, that we vow to bear witness to our faith. So what does it mean to give God our witness? That may sound terrifying to some of you. It does not mean, as Methodists, we are very flexible on this. Very flexible. So don't feel like it means, oh, I have to memorize 12 different scriptures and have them ready to go on all my notes. I don't memorize well at all. For those of you who can, God bless you. I love you to death. You're great to hang out with. I just can't keep up with you. That's not how I can bear witness. By simply coming to our worship services, in person and online, you bear witness to your faith by showing up. Not just showing up for God, but showing up for each other. We bear witness to each other's faith by simply coming together. Throughout this week, we can share our faith in encouraging, nurturing, healing ways through compassionate listening and asking someone, would you like for me to include you in my prayers? If they haven't, I've never in the wild public when talking with someone, and I mean a complete stranger, like checking out at the grocery store, how's your day going? First of all, it surprises them that I make eye contact and engage in conversation. Retail people are so accustomed to being ignored, it will shock them if you actually treat them like a human being. That is one way to bear witness to our faith that all people are children of God and should be treated like it. Just say hi. If you engage in conversation with them and they share, oh, it's been a bad day. This went wrong, that went wrong. If you feel led, you could say, would you like for me to include you in my prayers? That will absolutely shock people. And you will be surprised how often they say, why, yes, thank you. You don't have to mention God. You don't have to mention our church. You don't have to mention Jesus. You don't have to quote Bible verses. It really is this simple. And it really is that giving back to God is not just a one-time event. It is not a checklist on your to-do list, a checkbox. It is an ongoing journey. Giving back to God is about living with intention, using our gifts of our time, our talents, our treasures, to create a more just and compassionate world. Giving back to God is about recognizing and loving the divine spark in ourselves and in others. As we go into each day, let us love more deeply, serve more generously, and live in a way that reflects the beauty and the wonder of the gifts that God has given us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's take a moment to quietly reflect on today's reading, message, and the incredible gifts that God has given us.
Thank you.
Please join me as we share our thanks and our concerns and our joys and sorrows with God. Resurrecting God in a doubting world, keep us in the faith that we may have life. We pray for the church universal, breathe on us your Holy Spirit, that they may honor and pass on us the great inheritance that we have received. We pray for Mother Earth that we may touch her wounds and healing care and love. God of creation, we come today humbled by challenges and trials facing our world. We lift up all those impacted by devastating earthquakes in Taiwan, as well as powerful storms that have swept across the United States. In your infinite wisdom and compassion, please provide comfort, strength, and hope to all who are suffering. This morning, we pray especially for people participating in recovery groups, seeking healing and restoration. Guide them on journey and surround them with your loving support. Give them the courage to face each day and the perseverance to overcome the obstacles in their path. As parents, grant us wisdom and patience as we guide our children and grandchildren. Help us to be the loving, nurturing role models you need us to be for them. Grow your abilities to listen, to understand, and to provide the support and encouragement they require to grow into compassionate, responsible adults. Hold us as we cling to your promises of love, grace, and redemption. May your Spirit fill us with the strength and courage to face whatever challenges we face each day. We trust in faithful presence and give all our thanks to you. Finally, we take a moment to silently pray for those listed by name in today's program, as well as the names and the faces of people who we know, people who want to have a closer relationship with you. Pray all of this in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Help us resist temptation, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
In the Methodist tradition, we believe that all people are creations of God, children of God. And as such, you are all welcome to participate in this sacred act of communion. This sacred time of reminding ourselves of our connection with God, with nature, and with each other. We use the natural elements of bread and juice to remind us of how God nurtures our bodies and our souls. In doing this, we give back to God. God has given us this space and this time. God has given us these elements of bread and juice. And we give back to God in the sense of saying, we are pausing. We are pausing to be with each other. We are pausing to take in these elements. We are pausing to reflect on them and God's meaning in our lives. We give
give back to God by being with Him. Roughly 2,000 years ago, Jesus was having a last meal with his closest followers, the nine who would be betrayed to the Romans. At some point during that meal, that sacred time together, Jesus took bread from the table, gave thanks to God, broke it, and shared it with everyone there, saying, "Take and eat, all of you. This is the bread of life. This is my presence made real for all of you. Take and eat. Do this whenever you gather in remembrance of me." Later in the meal, Jesus took a cup of common table wine and used grape juice, gave thanks to God, and shared it with everyone there, including the one who would deny him, all of them who ran, the one who would betray him, and all of them who had so many questions. And he shared it with all of them, saying, "Take and drink, all of you. This is the cup of new life, the cup of a new promise, the cup of a new hope, given for all of you. Do this in remembrance of me." And so we do. As Christians have gathered for all these many, many centuries, we gather again with family and friends to celebrate our faith, to celebrate our connection to God and each other. I invite you to take a moment as we prepare to receive these elements and reflect again on all that God has given you. As you come forward to receive the elements, place a hand of blessing on the prayer shawls up here. These shawls are handmade by our members and go out to those who are at home and in the hospitals recovering. These shawls were knitted with prayers, and we ask you to add to those prayers with your touch of blessing. For the service, please come. Thank you.
talking with us. This week, we were in chapter 12, where Jesus challenged us to consider what is mundane and what is sacred. Immediately after this interaction with Pharisees and Sadducees, a scribe approaches Jesus and asks him, "What's the most important commandment?" They have an interesting interaction. I encourage you to read the rest of chapter 12 this week. It's a good meeting one. All right. I am generally not a hellfire and brimstone kind of preacher. If you like hellfire and brimstone kind of messaging, come back next week. Because we're moving into chapter 13. Lucky 13. Jesus lays it out. It's a tough chapter. Basically, you're going to be bad stuff's coming. Y'all are going to be miserable. There's going to be all sorts of horrible stuff happening. But don't worry about it. Like, no kidding. People get hung up on all the, here's all the bad stuff, and we completely ignore a couple of lines in there where Jesus says, don't worry about it. So, if that sounds interesting, come back next week. If it doesn't, come back next week and ignore me and enjoy the music. All right. For today, let's close with this blessing before our final song. May you all notice this week all that God has given you. May you notice your soul stirring within you. May you notice love flowing to, through, and from you. And may you all notice a resurrection of peace and hope in your hearts and minds. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Have a wonderful week. Please rise for our closing.